Till now, we were focusing on how to make multiple teams working together. What kind of coordination, engagement, management we should put in place so that people can work together. Now, we have not touched upon an enterprise level scaling thing, like how do we ensure the business case for which the project or an initiative has been started is getting implemented by these teams. How do we integrate the people who are doing portfolio planning with the team who are doing development? So in case of a scaled agile framework, the scaling is looked in both dimensions. It talks about how to integrate a business initiative with an execution, and how to ensure that the working, coordination, replanning, dependency management when multiple people work together. So these are the two dimensions which are looked into. So you might have seen something like this as a big picture. So this picture is more or less about like you have three layers. There is a portfolio layer, there is a program layer, and a team layer. So we have a presentation, I think. Here we will see this particular big picture, and it would be answering many of our queries. So let's go through the basic presentation, which gives a brief idea about what is there as a background of scaling, and then it gets into the framework as well. So this is a presentation which is available at scaleagileframework.com. You can download it, and it gives the complete idea of scaling. So yeah, so use this guideline, you can use it. So they talk about, start about that things are changing very fast. And Murphy's Law, which talks about that every few years, months, the technology is moving fast. So idea is that since technology is moving fast, we need to also do things faster. And a lot of time we think of that as a software developer, we work like very innovative and creative process. But in reality, many of things like a software developer is something like, okay, you have hundreds of developers doing things. So rather than creative work, it is many times looked as just an execution work, which is becoming more and more commoditized. So this is like an theory and a practice which are behind SAFe. Now people, like when I present SAFe to many people, they feel very happy when they see domain and all these things, all these people coming back. So many quality thinkers which keep talking about our performance improvement are considered, and their feedbacks and their views are well respected when we talk about SAFe. So here, the SAFe puts a good responsibility on management. Now, many times in agile approaches, we spoke about that management is something which creates more trouble than helping us in solving problem. But in SAFe, we believe that management is someone who really owns the system. If they commit, it's not only that they believe in quality, they need to commit for a quality, and they are the one who brings bigger changes in the process. So be agile, it's like waterfall versus agile, which we don't have to look into. So agile delivers things faster. So it's like that if you are delivering via agile, you deliver incremental values. So value get delivered faster. If you deliver at the end, in a waterfall process, the value comes at the end. So it's like delivering fast and incremental way, and then things. So this is something which is a basic. Now this is a scaled agile framework. Now it's a public-facing proven framework which talks about four core values: program execution, alignment, code quality, and transparency. These are the four values SAFe starts with. And it says that we need to have a proactive and clear approach of managing multiple teams. See, when we work with multiple teams, it becomes like a program management problem where dependencies, is replanning, which impact, and you may have a shared resources also who serves to the multiple team. So you need to look the problem or the scenario of working with a multiple team as a program management problem. So you create a layer which does a program management. It
it is more or less similar with our traditional program management, who does a coordination and integration of multiple teams. Alignment, that the focus of safe alignment is there should be a clear alignment between portfolio, program and team. It's not sufficient to keep delivering just a team backlog or a few stories and few features until unless you have a clear alignment between the business goals and execution. I was working in a one company and we had a problem. Like till the time company small size was small, we were getting limited amount of project, it was doing well. So problem was that we had a sales team. It was like a R&D group, kind of PD group you can think of, product company. You can raise a request and we have to work on it and we will fix on it. So the request raising thing was given to the sales people or a pre-sales people. So whenever they want to have a modification in a product or whenever they get a new idea about a product, they used to initiate a request, and that particular request could lead to a 3 months, 6 months or 12 months long project into a R&D group. So this process was quite open. Anybody in a sales group could raise the request, and then as per the availability, we used to do a weekly meeting, and as per the availability of resources, we used to allocate people. That's it. Now, when size increased, we realized that team were working on many low value things. There was no centralized group who takes decision about that if I have three requests, which one I should be allocating to a R&D group. Finally, they come up with a concept called portfolio. So what this portfolio team does, did is, they used to have a meeting every 3 months, at a frequency, and at that particular frequency, they look at whatever is recommended by the sales team, and according to the scenarios and frequency, they figure it out which one will go into the R&D group. And then they created a dedicatedly small group to take care of immediate issues, like some fixes, something which can be done in a 1 week, 2 weeks time. So for that, they give a dedicated capability to their sales team. And for the rest of the work, they brought the prioritization process. It worked good. So we started the prioritization process. Now we went into a second problem. What? We have a lot of prioritization things. Projects are approved. And one approved project started. It has not finished. But again, three projects are already approved. Now when this project is finished, there are three same priority projects are already approved by the team which they met 3 months, 6 months ago. They approved it, but we could not take them. Now, when we have to pick up, again the politics comes into the picture. Whoever pushed the project faster, that project starts working on other 2-3 stages waiting. Now, this problem could have been fixed. I left that company after when we were at this particular point, bringing back integration, bringing back the status of what team doing to our decision making process, and also limiting approvals. Like you cannot approve more than two projects till the time other two are not complete. Putting some work in progress limits, and that is what SAFE talks of. It says that we need to align that business group level decisions, thinking, and the execution which is done at the team level so that we do the right prioritization, and the prioritization also includes the capacity and execution in picture. And that is where the alignment is focusing. Alignment of portfolio, program and teams. Code quality, as with other frameworks, you cannot scale bad code. So you need to have good engineering practices. If the integration takes you 1 week, you cannot scale. Simple. So it's like if we don't have automation in our testing, can we scale it? You may not be able to build product faster or frequently if that test process is automated well. Now they do talk about proper terms for it. They talk about transaction cost and holding cost. So I keep giving a bread example. Like how frequently we should deliver bread. Like I'm a bread manufacturer. I have a factory in Noida. Okay, how frequently I should deliver bread to Atta and Mayur Vihar and Lajpat Nagar. Now, when I take my van, out of 10-20 stores at each location, some stores will be always out of bread. Yeah. So should I keep delivering bread as I have, and when I manufacture bread, my breads will not last for more than 5 days. I need to throw them away, like I need to distribute them. And if I don't distribute them, the person who is coming to a shop, if he doesn't find a bread, he will eat something else or he will buy some other bread. He will not wait for me. So I lose money. If my breads are not there, my money is gone. So in such a scenario, how do I decide my holding cost, the cost which I am paying by not distributing bread. Because market is losing, somebody is buying, eating paratha rather than bread, and the cost which goes into transaction, transportation cost. So if I start delivering one bread, stupidity, I am sending my truck for a one bread, or a 10 bread, or 20 bread. So I need to find a balance. I need to find a balance that how many bread I can push. And this balance is a function of what is the cost of holding the bread and what is the cost of transporting the bread. And it should be an optimal. So if I start transporting on a bike, I will have a small bag size. If I will start transporting on a truck, I will have a big bag size. Same goes for our coding. If our transaction cost is high, transaction cost high means it takes more time to do a regression testing, it requires more time to integrate, it requires a big effort to make the build move to the potential shippable increment. This is your transaction cost. If it is high, it's a stupidity to give every week build. Because your team is spending big time, more time testing the same thing again and again. So you can't give a small batch. It's like same bread example. Like if you are only have a truck and you want one bread to go via truck, doesn't make sense. You need to have a bike. So same way, you need to have a code quality which can make your integration like this, which can bring down your transaction cost so that your batch size can be. So that is the kind of concept which SAFe recommends and give you a context that, okay, figure it out, think about this and make sure that your code quality is good. Transparency, now many times, even the team who represents and uses Agile, they are very transparent inside, but they are very opaque outside. So here the meaning of transparency, and SAFe do believes in matrices and all, he says that I should have a transparency at this level and this level. It's just not that I keep approving the portfolio, the example I was giving. Like portfolio group was approving projects and we people were delayed. So there is no transparency to them or there is no process back going to them that if you either, like you might have studied, killing project is a very rare event. Why? Because the information doesn't go back and people find it difficult to kill the project to approve the another one. If you have a real transparency which says that it's better to kill this project now, even if you have spent, say, $1 million on it, because the remaining time can give you more money if you work on something else. So the SAFe recommends that there should be a mechanism where things are transparent. So that is something which is, you can think of like more holistic and detailed approach of handling and things. So 2012, it started in version 1.1 and we have a 3.0 now and 4.0 will be coming in August 2015. So it's like they are ensuring that we are adapting. It's not like a fixed thing. It's inspect and adapt and they are learning from things. The core fundamental of SAFe roots are Agile. They take Agile as a base. This is something called product development flow. It's a book written by Donald Reinsertion, and it's a modification of a critical chain and Toyota principles in a product development environment. Because in a Toyota principles, you have a very fixed monolithic products. You have a car which you have to deliver. So how those kind of processes needs to be modified in a software development or engineering development project, that is something which is taken care in a product development flow. And Lean is the another one where it focuses on. Written by Dean, again, there were books. So there are always books before these frameworks. So he wrote a book called Scaling Software Agility, Agile Software Requirements, and there was a managing. These two books I have read, and they represent the core concepts which were finally came as a framework. So he is like IUP, UML, and he did a lot of coaching and other things. So there were other contributors, and then we have communities and we have a practice. So yeah, so it's like final thoughts on Agile method. So we focus on Scrum teams. Now we saw Nexus, we saw Less. If you ask, can there be a one team not following Scrum in Less? Like, can there be a one team not following Scrum in Nexus? They will say no. Everything should be Scrum. But it's okay in SAFe. You may have a one team following Kanban. Because they may be doing the support process for you, they can remain on your group, but they follow Kanban. So it's not like too much binded to it, but yes, usually the core teams, collection of teams would be Scrum teams. Then you have extreme programming practices and you would be using Kanban, especially at a portfolio level and sometime at a team level also, to ensure the visibility and managing the employees. So that is how it works. So system view, we keep focusing on system view, we're focusing on it's like scaling and all those things. Yeah. So this is a big picture which I was trying to show in this particular diagram. So if you go to a URL scaledagileframework.com, you get this picture. Let me show it. Because this is just a pointer thing. This is how it will be. And you click on anywhere, it takes you to the complete page and explains it. So this is a complete book which is available for Scaled Agile Framework. Once you have an idea, this is your reference. And anytime, every time when you open it, you will find something new. So for example, if you want to learn about what is this team backlog, what is this all about, you get it here. Now before, let's talk about few concepts. Before I get into the framework. Now I want to talk about how the content is managed. Now safe talk about requirement hierarchy as well. Now what is requirement? What is requirement? Give me an example of requirement.
User story.
User story. As a user, what is the requirement?
Login functionality.
So what is the difference between functionality and requirement? Login is a functionality or login is a requirement?
Login is a functionality, that is a requirement.
The functionality of the software, but requirement for the user.
The functionality that fulfills the requirement is what somebody wants, and functionality is what needs to be done.
True. So now there are layers of requirement, well said. And this is a business analysis domain. We teach business analysis also nowadays. So there are business requirement. Why do you need to an authentication? I need to have a website so that I can attract traffic. I want to sell training online. So I need an online portal. So that's my business requirement. Now, after that, you have a stakeholder requirement. That, okay, as a trainer, I should be able to do this. As a student, I should be able to do this, and etc. And finally, we have a functional requirement or a solution requirement. Where we talk about login screen, where we talk about search, where we talk about dashboard, where we talk about small things which we can implement it. In the same fashion, so this is a business requirement, sometimes also known as a business need. So this is a stakeholder requirement or a stakeholder need, then you have a solution requirement or functionality requirement which comes here. Now, in a safe, here if you look at a portfolio level, you have something called epics. They use the word epic, which they talk about business epics. Business epics are big functionalities where and supported by proper business case. Think like that, I'm a job site, should I do social media integration or should I go for mobile app? So these are two business app I'm evaluating. Or these are the two business epics I'm evaluating on the basis of their business case. And this is where the portfolio groups come into picture. They look at the business case of it, they look at our capability, our capacities, strategic alignment, availability of budget, and on that basis they approve it. Then it gets converted into features. Now features is an industry term which represents a bigger set of functionality. So it should have a dashboard feature. It should have single sign-on feature. So it's a bigger things which comes at a feature. Finally, they get converted into small functionality which are stories. In the same way it works. So it is something like when epic level we talk about portfolio group, at a program management level we talk at a feature group. So program management is a group which takes care of multiple teams. At a team level we talk about user stories or stories. So this is how the backlog is. Backlog is, we talk about three views of a backlog. One is a portfolio backlog. Which will have epics. Then from a portfolio backlog, you will create a program backlog. And from a program backlog, you will create a team backlog. The but they are related, but they are expanded.
And they're one to many relationship.
Yeah, they are one to many relationship. And you may have few items which are coming directly here, may not have parallel relationship. With that, that level of flexibility is also here. But it is like, that is how it is viewed. So you talk about big things here. At a portfolio level, I don't want to talk about user story authentication and all. I just want to talk about where am I. When I'm talking at a program level, what is program level? A one unit where multiple teams are managed. Okay, this is a content authority. Now look at the project management team. There is a something called agile release train. Now, Ankit, you have release train or release management may come into the picture. So this is something like, it talks about that we need to have a program management group. So program management group is someone who takes care of multiple teams. So multiple teams, so and this is as a term is called agile release train in case of SAFe. So agile release train is a virtual group of multiple agile teams. So if you have 9 teams working as a one group, you will say agile release train. The size of a one team could be 55 to 125 people. If you need more, then you need to create a separate train. So what is train? You can think of that you may have a one backbone layer, train layer, which takes care of remaining people, and others are team. So you will have a program manager here, which you can talk about chief scrum master. You will have a chief product owner or a group of people who manage product. You will have a technical architect here. You will have a UX guideline here. You will have a DevOps team here. You may have system teams here, which does many, many supporting work. So this is how the teams are organized. So they have a, and such kind of, in a given portfolio, you may have multiple such teams. So a one team means up to 125 people, but if you have an MS project, MS Office kind of project, you may run multiple trains, and they are linked by a given portfolio. Okay, so this is how the team structure looks like. In the case of SAFe.
So a train means a portfolio team. Sorry, program team.
Program team. So in a general language, you can think of a group of teams is train.
Right.
And metaphor is train will have a bogies. So bogies are team, and the people who maintain and keep the train running are the people who are sitting at a program layer, and they are the one who has the responsibility of keeping things. I asked a specific question to an access trainer that don't you think that integration team is a program team? He says, yeah, you can think like that. So it's like you can even take it like an integration team, but yeah, it's a more about management and focus related things rather than direct doing the
work. Who all are in portfolio team?
Portfolio team is a business owner's team. Now, for example, somebody in PB has an idea of a new product in your sales group. And they are doing a research about that new version of a map. That's a portfolio group. And this portfolio group could be segmented. For example, in a PB level, you may have a one group which looks at a telecommunication area, the another segment which looks at a GIS area, geolocation area. So this becomes a one portfolio. So the GIS strategic business unit is a one portfolio. Under GIS, you may have a multiple programs. And those programs are meeting your portfolio backlog because they want to do multiple things. So they get a budget allocated for their area and then they do it.
So like, is there anything like we can have up to 125 people under one program? So is there any restriction for portfolio? Like we can only have 2 programs under one portfolio?
No such restriction has been given. But as he raised that, what if the multiple teams has to integrate with each other? So what SAFe says is that if there are multiple trains and their solution has to be integrated before it goes out, then you may need to create a similar kind of program management layer for these trains.
Okay.
So, exactly. So same like the hierarchy which when we were talking about Nexus we were presenting. So if you have multiple teams, then you may need to have a one team which integrates it. So the same way you may have a program management team which is sitting here. So if you relate with each other, you will find that there are concepts, this is a core concept which they are but yeah, there are refinements and there are things which are done differently.
And what if in this case one program management team has dependency on the other?
So
they're not working together. Really, but the same thing. That one
yeah, something. And either you need to treat it as a vendor.
Okay.
So in a vendor case, you just manage the improvements the way you manage any vendor. If you have more dependencies, then you create the middleware. Because many times, SAFe is also used with hardware dependencies. Because there are like companies like Philips, they use SAFe and they do have a hardware dependency.
Right.
Like they need to have a hardware to test the version before it can go second. And that becomes quite crazy, like a lot of, because they can't change so frequently. So hardware will have more predictable life cycle than the software thing. So this is how the content, this is how the structure. Now, final thing which I want to talk about is the project delivery, how the delivery happens. And then you can look at the big picture, which will be showing you some more idea. So what is said in a SAFe is something called program increment. So you may have, first you need to identify something called program increment duration, PI. Now you can think of it as more or less like a release, but it is not release. There is a technical difference in it, but just for simplicity's sake, I am saying that you can think of it as a release. So what we do, we need to plan for this program increment. Okay, now recommendation is, we run a 2 weeks sprint. So it's like 10-week thing. To start this thing, the first thing you do in SAFe is something called release planning meeting. Now in a release planning meeting, it is expected that all teams who would be running here come and agree to something called PI objective. They agree at an objective level, not at a detail level. They agree on what they want to do in this 10 weeks time. So objective means more like a program backlog. So what they look at is a program backlog, which is a features. So they will talk about feature 1, feature 2, feature 3, and this is a program backlog. They pick up some features, up to 10 features for this discussion, and they come up with an objective. Now this objective is an aggregation of team's objective. What does it mean? In this particular meeting, each team will create their objective, which will get aggregated into complete PI objective. So in a simple sake, you can think of that we had a meeting and we decided that at the end of 10 weeks, which all features we want to do. And we can commit to do, or what we think that we would be able to deliver it. When you do this particular meeting, you end up identifying dependencies, you create a program board, and you identify that, okay, on the basis of your velocity, capacity, you come up with that, okay, this is something we can deliver. So this is a starting point. Meeting, this is done, then you come back, and at a team level, here, you will create your team backlog. From where it is coming? On the basis of your objective. So your program objective works as an input to your team backlog, and each team will be working on their team backlog. Once done, every sprint, team works as per the team backlog. Okay, and they will follow all the three roles, Scrum Master, Product Owner, etc., etc. And these features are managed by a product management group, which is a senior product managers are here. These backlogs are managed by something called Product Owner, which you can more or less like think of a business analyst rather than a big product owner. And they need to keep reporting to the product management. So you can think of that on a frequently basis,
in this 2 weeks time, multiple time, they do a PO scrum of scrum, where all product management people meet and decide what they are doing and what they want to do. And similarly, they do scrum masters scrum of scrum, where they meet and talk about dependencies and interdependencies and issues. So they keep an alignment through these meetings, and then they keep working on it, and at the end of 2 weeks, they deliver working software. Now this working software, not necessary to be an integrated solution at this stage. They need to give this demo to their respective product owner. The program management group will not look at it. But there is a separate team, which is called system team, which will pick their work at the end of 2 weeks and create an integrated demo for program management team every 2 weeks. So it may happen that my sprint has finished Friday, system team picks the data, and they give an integrated demo on Tuesday. But my team is doing the next work. I am forward. And they will be the one who will be giving demo to the middle level stakeholders. We keep working.
Looks pretty much like integration team in Excel, right?
Yeah. So, the complete work, this is integration team. Because the system team is only responsible for technical integration. They are not responsible for coordination, they are not responsible for technical architects and all. So here, your complete thing is an integration team. So they keep integrating and they keep showing it, yeah.
So how do we work if one of the teams is working in Kanban?
Yeah, so Kanban kind of team will be a system team or a DevOps team where you don't have a predictable flow of work, where things keeps coming and you need to work on it. So they work as a service provider to various teams. There could be an infrastructure team which does just the setups and infrastructure related work. So as and when you have a need, you do that.
So
right.
My software team should not be following Kanban?
Yes, your software team, if following Kanban, then they may not be able to commit to a team objective and program objective. So there would be a problem.
But the maintenance team, I mean, the software maintenance
team,
they would be following.
They can follow. So that's why they can think of DevOps or somebody who has upper level.
So will they still be following 2 week sprints in that case? Or?
Yes. So if you are following Kanban, then it's no sprint.
Yeah.
So it's like continuous flow.
That's why I ask you, sir. Do they still need to align?
They are like a service provider. And all these teams should have a synchronized sprint.
Yeah.
Teams. Means they start on the same day, they finish on the same day. And they keep working for 4 sprints, and the last PI, means every 4 weeks, we keep a blank sprint. You are talking about doing sprint zero for every release.
Mm-hmm.
So what they talk about is that we work in a program increment, which is by default 5 sprint, could be 6 sprint or 4 sprint. And the last sprint of program increment is blank, no work, except you plan for the next. You do release planning. You do this meeting. You do some cleaning work which is left. You may do some overall retrospectives and other integrated things. In case the weakness of, say, for instance, of the many who criticize is, we don't do integrated retrospective at the end of every sprint. The integrated retrospective is only done at the end of PI. In between, the team does their own. So this is more or less it works like. Then we can look at a big picture and we give you some more idea.
A couple of questions. Does it also go prescriptive in terms of how the business testing should happen, how many integration testing should happen?
Nothing like that.
It doesn't go in that.
Does it go into that? And even many times people feel that CF is very prescriptive. But CF keep talking about the template.
Yeah.
It's just a template. You need to modify it before you really use it. It does talk about various goals. That's true. But many times you may merge many roles. It talks about that there should be a technical architect who is sitting here and who gives a technical guidance to the teams, UX guidance to the team. And they follow that particular UX things and produce the capabilities.
What layer does the product management
sector? Product management is a program layer.
Program
features. So stakeholder required, they collect the features. So you got an epic that yes, we want to make a mobile app. So product management will think of the features of mobile app. And the business analysis or product owner will think of the small user stories which the team will be working on every sprint.
And
program management to manage the whole release.
Yes. So there is a group called release management, which is like chaired by something called release train engineer, which is like a chief scrum master. And this group is, you can think of that every week they meet and they look at how integratedly we are moving towards our PI objectives. So there is a proper release management group. The membership would be the people from requirement would be joining in, because the product management group will be part of it, and the project management people will also join in, which is like a scrum master or another.
And I believe the systems teams are also invited to the demos, because they are the people.
System team is the one which gives the demo, which creates the infrastructure for the demo,
yes.
And program team is the one which gives the demo to the bigger stakeholders. So system team is an essential part of system demos. So
not of the sprint demos?
No, not this.
But how will they integrate until they understand what
the sprint demo is more to do with the product functionality. System team is more focused on technological integration. They are not necessarily focusing on it, but again, adaption can be happen. And if you talk about working software, there are three types of working software in sales. One is we call working software, which is at a sprint level. Then we talk about working solution. This is software, this is working solution, which is at a system team level, where everything is integrated. And then we talk about releasable solution, which may come at any point in time, many times at the end of PI, which goes out to the market. So you can create a separate definition of done at these three levels, and this is how it works. Because they accept the fact that, okay, we cannot do everything here. There will be few things which will be done at this level, there will be few things which will be done at a releasable level. So such kind of concepts are built into it, which gives you a visibility and how things can be. It's a concept called value stream. So value stream is, you can say that you can create a group on the basis of value stream. Value stream is that a steps or a process which you take to deliver value. For example, if you are Airtel, so Airtel could have a voice as a value stream, data is another value stream, value-added services is the third value stream. So these are value streams which helps them to earn money. So at a portfolio level, you can have a multiple value streams. And for each value stream, you may need to have a team which can take care of the project related to that particular value stream. So here you have a portfolio which follows some evaluation process, Kanban boards and other things. Then you have agile release train. So this is the agile release train. You have a role like agile release train engineer, system architect, UX, DevOps, shared people. You have a vision, portfolio, and you create a program backlog here. So at a portfolio level, you have a portfolio backlog. Here you have a program backlog, and then you have a team backlogs. You do a release planning meeting, and you come up with a program level PI objective, you come with a team level PI objectives. And with the help of team level PI objectives, the product owner creates team backlogs. These are the sprints, and you have a last sprint which is kept as an innovation and planning, where you can do say hackathon and also do a planning for the next one. You keep showing working system here. The system demo is done at a program management here. So you have a system demo which is done at the end of every sprint. Idea is the system demo may lack. Like it may be delayed by some time. Like you are done with an integration, because the integration may take some time. You should try that integration duration should be shrinking. Like the lag should be shrinking, but there could be a possibility where it lacks. The maximum lag it can have is one sprint. So you cannot delay it by more than 2 weeks. If the previous sprint system demo should be given before this particular sprint is over. They people are focusing on features. So value is getting delivered by features here. Here you have a user stories, and there you have an epics. And there are some special type of prioritization tools, which is called WSJF, which helps you to do the prioritization.
So this team backlog is same as sprint backlog?
Yeah. So team backlog kya hai? Dekho, aapne bhi, you have made a program PI objective. Out of program PI objective, for example, you have picked three functions, features.
Mm-hmm.
Now for these three features, you need to create user stories. You need to split them further. You have splitted them further, which may convert into a 30 user stories.
Okay.
Now in next 4 sprints, you will do these 30 user stories. And it may keep refining further. When you go into a particular sprint, out of those 30, you will pick 2 or 3. So it is not a sprint backlog. You can think of it's a backlog for your PI increment.
Yes.
So, and again, once the PI is over, it will get again refreshed.
release level backlog sort of.
Even the team level ka
but team work. Still prepares a backlog for each sprint.
Yeah, sprint level तो अलग है.
वो अलग है. But that वो तो होता ही है.
But you mentioned even.
So now the scrum level ceremonies they have not mentioned it clearly. They just said all scrum master, product owner, agile team, all those roles exist. So that is something that we do, and we do a planning and we do a demo and retrospective. So this is something we do. Not much clear, but we do it at this point. Now another philosophy which they talk about is develop on cadence and release on demand. So what does it mean? There is a term called cadence. What is cadence?
Rhythm.
Rhythm, flow. Time boxing is the one way of doing cadence. So, and there could be another way of doing cadence. For example, you are a technical architect and you need to get the code reviewed whenever, before you finish your work. Now, what do you do? You have a code, then you start following up with the technical architect. When can we meet? I have a code review. He says that I was available yesterday, but you didn't inform me. Now I don't have time. So you end up into doing all those things. And this is an asynchronous planning. The another way of doing it is that, yes, you have a technical architect. He says that every Thursday and Friday, I'm available 3 to 6. Now, whenever you have a work, you make sure that you keep it ready for Thursday. And if you miss getting that work on Thursday, you know it will happen on next Thursday. Simple. So that is a cadence. Cadence brings a predictability. It makes things more managed. And this is how it should be done if you are following a cadence approach. Now, we do a planning in a cadence. What does it mean? We will keep planning always for 10 weeks, for an example. So our PI increment will be always for 10 weeks. But there could be cases that I want to give a release after 2 weeks, or 3 weeks, or 4 weeks. So what I do, you still plan for 6 weeks, but after 3 weeks you plan a release. So the recommendation of CA is always do development in cadence and release on demand. So majority of time, that's why I said that by default you can take it as a release duration, but technically it is wrong. Because you may have release in between. We don't want to change our rhythm because we have a smaller feature or bigger feature to release. We will be always doing, so you can think of there are two level of sprints. 2 weeks sprints and PI increment, which is a 10 weeks increment. And not necessarily every 10 week increment give a release. You may have a release coming in between. You may have 2-3 increments, PI increments before the release starts going out. But still, it has to be 10 weeks planning. So that way, it is a bit different from release planning. Yeah.
So when you say 10 weeks, so let's say, one PI, I have 10 weeks. I crossed one sprint. So this is when again I will add one more week of do one more sprint of planning, or after that PI time frame I have is when I do it for 10 weeks.
Yes. Okay. So PI itself is like a one box.
It's not a continuous.
It's not continuous. And when you are finishing at a PI, then you will compile and integrate and you will do a release planning meeting where everybody will come on.
Sure.
Big level activity will happen. Okay, so this is how it is done. Now there are few differences which are sometimes controversial also, but they believe that is something which is needed. One is they talk about something concept called architectural runway. Now what does it mean? It says that system architecture cannot be left self-organizing. There should be a proactive approach to provide guidance for architecture and UX. So they talk about a role called system architect. And this person should think about architecture maybe a bit ahead than team. He may create some basic infrastructure which is needed for the other teams to plug in. And how does he create it? He creates it by creating features. Red kind of cards. So he creates red cards which are non-functional development things. And those red cards are finally divided to the team only. He will not be doing the complete coding, but he is the one who ensures that we still follow right responsible movement, but he ensures that things are integrated and he becomes like a product owner for architectural related work. So you can think of that there will be technical stories which are written by technical architect, which goes into teams also, and he is the one who will accept it, and those technical stories will help us to keep the architecture consistent and ensure that we are grooming the architecture at a system level. So That's the clear direction. Now, other framework we spoke about, they don't talk about it. You may do like this, or you may find another way. It says that this is the way you can do it because it ensures there is a good integration in a technical direction.
So I can probably have a sprint running of architects only, who are actually grooming the architecture, who are thinking ahead and bringing up the architecture.
Yeah, so that is something not recommended. You should not be centralizing the complete implementation of architecture. The architecture should be more or less like a guidelines, but you should take in contribution from the team in building the architecture so that knowledge goes till deep. Because what happens, the problem with the first approach is many times we create a great architecture, but when we start implementing it, we face the real problem. And when the team is not that much confident about what they are facing, they find ways to handle the current architecture. So they will code something which works with the current architecture. So that is why to remove that kind of resistance, we need to bring that to the team level. So they remain open, but again, guidance is needed.
Yeah, again, to add to this point that Saurabh mentioned, and the project that I was working in, we had architects in various sprint teams, various teams, but all those architects also used to have a weekly meeting with the chief architect.
Community of practice. Yes. So this is something which can be added, not explicitly so said here. This is kind of a community of practice, or community of practice only, where team are having a designated person who works with closely with an architect, and similar community of practice can exist for testing, for development, to ensure that we have a similar kind of coding rules, to ensure we have similar kind of code, tools, everybody is working on the same version of
the dependencies, they used to get addressed in those meetings, because at times, architect from my team was not aware that how the changes need to be done in the other team.
True.
So the architects would have that discussion in that meeting, and then both of them would go back to their respective teams and communicate.
Community
of
practice.
Yeah. So in the last team thing, I see code quality, there are three things which are written.
Yeah, agile architecture, continuous integration, test first. So these are the three specifically mentioned.
So the safe model goes a little bit more prescriptive about this, or it's just these terms?
It just says that you need to follow focusing on emergent architecture. You should be focusing on continuous integration. Continuous integration is kind of must.
Mm-hmm.
You can't live without continuous integration at this scale. And then test first is kind of not that must, but yeah, it's something you should be adapting to. But CI is becoming like default now.
You're right.
Everybody is thinking doing this scale development without CI is not possible.
For example, I'm planned for one PI, it comes with say two releases, like you said, release on demand. So 2 weeks sprint, say 12 weeks, and after the third sprint, I give a release, okay? Now the system team is integrating it, and once they integrate everything and they prepare the demo, they find that there are many critical bugs in the system. Now, if I go ahead with the development, because the other teams have, the three sprints goals are already defined, right? But those bugs needs to be fixed. What happens to those?
Yeah. So now what is no prescription. And even we had a good amount of discussion in our safe agilist group also. So how the bugs are handled, especially the one which are coming at an integration level. There is no clear prescription. The only 2-3 things which I want to mention here is system team has to be doing an integration every sprint. So the integration bugs should be detected fast. Now, who fixes the integration bug actually depends upon how the teams are organized. So if you can identify a particular bug directly going to a team, you can allocate it. But if you can't, then you may need to have an integration team kind of setup which takes care of all those things.
But it may impact the velocity of that team because they already have some backlog items, right?
So it may impact, and again the inspect and adapt is there. But there is no clear prescription about how to handle bugs. If you ask them, they will say there should not be bug. So which is not a right like answer, but they say that bug should not exist, you should finish it as it comes and all those fundas. But again, yeah, it is a great big great things, and especially when it comes to that you are done with the PI and you so where does it go? Does it go here and get redistributed to the team, or it remains with the team? So again, it depends upon how the teams are organized. So if you have a team which takes care of one area, then by default all the bugs which are coming in that area goes to the
many of the bugs, they don't come when you're doing a PI for a particular team, but when the integration
happens,
after integration you'll have n number of bugs, so the number of bugs increase exponentially, and that is where teams need to figure out whether it will, which bucket it falls into, which team needs to decide.
That gets resolved if you have strong continuous integration practices.
Yes, continuous integration practice, and then you have a complete program management layer. So you have a release team engineer to take care of the coordination and dependency, and those kind of issues are managed in time. And this person is expected to do two scrum of scrum in a week. And you have a release management group which takes care of the impact on velocities. Like if we had these many defects, what do we do with them? How do we manage our release? Release management group will decide. So release management group is not a different people. People from this group only participate in a meeting. People like product management, release team engineer, system architect, some of the scrum master, they come together and they talk about what they are doing at the end of these 10 weeks.
You had said that each of these layers are very transparent. So if my team is running behind schedule, so does it get notified to the portfolio
yes.
immediately?
Yes, portfolio not necessary. So there are set of matrices. So we talk about ART matrices, we talk about portfolio matrices. So portfolio matrices don't get into the sprint level details. They definitely get into PI level details. So see, again an example, we keep talking about like scale. So when you are talking about taking auto to Atta, you will be worried about rupees, 10, 20 rupees or 50 rupees or 60 rupees. You will talk in a 10 domination. When you want to say buy a flat in Noida, you will talk in lakhs. You will not even talk about rupees. So similarly, then at a portfolio level, for them, the measurement unit is PI is more than enough. They don't want to get into rupees and those kind of stuff. So these people are more interested, which comes at the end of PI. And program management keeps looking at things at a regular basis, and they ensure that PI level they have something which is demonstrable, which takes the things at top.
So are there some descriptive metrics?
Yes, there are. So there are good amount of metrics which takes data like feature completion status. There is a very good metrics called release predictability index, and this release predictability index is based on program PI objective, which shows that how we meet our PI objectives. And it is less to do with velocity, it is more about value driven. That you have identified 10 items, you take some value point of those 10 items, and you keep figuring out on a PI level at how many value points you are earning, PI by PI. There are good amount of metrics.
If we go to the same website and we click on this, then we will
find yes, just for a, just to say yes, and just to give you a so if you click on ART metrics, it will open. Agile release train metrics, and it will show about all these things. And there are metrics, assessment metrics, learn now charts, and all those kind of stuff. So it's a lot of things.
It has. And you have added this recently. The last time I went through Scaled Agile framework on this website a couple of months back, this clicking thing is not.
Don't really know about it. You probably know
about it. It's been there. And that is actually the goal of our training and education is that we tell that how to use this. Once you know how to use this, it's on you. So our goal is that we just show you a direction and then you figure it out how to explore it further. And there is a LinkedIn group on Scale Agile Framework, you can join that. Less the big LinkedIn group I recently joined. So
how do you join that?
Search karlo. I scale the
thank you.
Okay, now how I come to know? Because of the network. For example, if you are connected with the people like many of us, you see a notification, Saket has joined Less Group. So people like when we have a decent network of required people, you don't have to search. When you stream, you can think of a big group. And then this trail is explained further.
Okay.
So this is a big box, and each train is these two. You will have multiple.
But value stream is anyway implemented at all layers, right?
Yes.
It's the concept of lean.
So it's a concept. So it's just a way of looking how we are thinking. So it is saying that you allocate team on the basis of value streams.
But the important point is each value stream may have one or more release trains.
Depending on the size of the stream.
Right.
Okay, so this is all like so it delivers and all those things. And yeah, now there are a bit theory behind it. So it talks about that we have a lean thinking house, which talks about the goal is value, the respect for people, product development flow, person, and foundation is leadership.
It was interesting. On the less website I saw with that, it's a huge blog that talks about lean product management.
And they criticize this particular flow indirectly. Because the product development flow is something which has little lean. But the original lean thinking house, which is coming from Toyota, they have a 14 different principles here. And they talk about leadership is not the base, so they kind of criticize this particular diagram and bring that original diagram here.
Okay.
So I also went into less and I said, okay, lean thinking. So controversies, yeah. So again, goal is sustainable, shorter lead time, better quality, and all these theories. So I think something which you can explore, theories. It's basically not how part of it, Kaizen. It's a product development flow, an interesting book, Don Richardson. Kind of boring, so you may not be able to read it in a one go. Bit expensive also, 2600 rupees. But yeah, it has interesting concepts like take an economic view. It talks about make decisions based on economics. What does it mean? Many times he says that should we release the software now or fix the 20 bugs? What should we do? He says that such kind of decisions should be made on the basis of cost of delay. You calculate the cost of delay, and if the cost of delay is higher by releasing it, don't do it. So you figure out what is an economic sense. Do I make more money by releasing it or not? If you don't release it. If you make, release it. So it is something like that kind of framework it puts into the place. Many times when we do a prioritization and other things, we don't talk about other factors, how it will make money. We only talk about technical quality, cycle time, and those things. So this is something goes at a bigger level. Queue management, it says that many times we start identifying lead times. Say, you have a product backlog. You get into a sprint, you deliver it. You may monitor the time of this sprint, that when it got selected and when it get deleted. If you have 100 items waiting here, do you manage them? They are just getting added to your product backlog. That's the queue management. And it says that it's a leading indicator. Means if you have 100 items waiting here, they will create mess picked. Because customer is expecting you to deliver it some point in time. So do we manage this queue proactively so that our flow remains smooth? And I keep giving an example of Haldiram and McDonald's. A lot of food example. So McDonald's, if there is a queue, what they will do? They will not take the reorder order. They will make sure that if I have taken 3 order, so if more people are coming, I will stop taking order till the time I deliver it. I create some buffer, I create some delivery here. Haldiram, if you end up visiting Ambience Mall Haldiram during peak hours, you will understand what I am talking about. They will have a separate cash counter. They will keep giving you. And then you are fighting at delivery counter. Yaar 20 minute ho gaye, yaar 25 minute ho gaye, yaar 30 minute ho gaye.
And at times you end up paying and don't getting the stuff.
Yeah. So both the places there is queue, but managed differently. Why? And that brings a different level of customer experience. At a McDonald's, you will not stay in the queue if you really want to have a burger because you are not paid. If you don't want to stand in the queue, go. I have not taken your money. Once I take your money, I will give you a delivery. Haldiram, you have paid. Now the only option with you is to fight with that delivery guy. कि भाई मेरा कहाँ है मेरा कहाँ है. पैसे तो हमने दे दिए. So the customer experience changes the way you manage your queues. So
Haldiram is an Indian brand.
It's just a way of managing queues and managing your WIPs. So they have, and it works good till the time you don't have a problem. So Haldiram will also work good till the time you are not hitting the weekend lunch hour. When you hit a weekend lunch hour, then only this issue will start coming in.
Unka practice managing cash.
So they don't want to lose the customer by not collecting money. Okay, pehle paisa to de, fir dekhenge. They are more worried about chala jayega to bina paisa di. That is they are more worried about. And McDonald's, they ensure that once I take the money, I deliver it in a given time. Once I take the money, else I don't take the money.
There is more one more point, that is जहाँ भी मंदिर है बगल में बीकानेर वाला है, so अगर यहाँ नहीं जाता तो वहाँ चला जाए,
ये वो ठीक है,
बीकानेर भी तो वैसे ही क्यों मैनेज,
So now this is kind of a principle it talks about. So this book, this is a collection of such kind of principles which are not directly coming to a software, but they gives you an idea that okay, I need to do something to manage my product backlog queue. I should not just keep adding. The example I was telling, the project is getting approved, it is getting into queue. If I can't deliver it in the next 6 months, I need to tell it now why they are pushing it more and more to me. I tell that I can't be able to do it. So that kind of principles we can use, talks about batch sizes, WIPs and all those kind of stuff.
So mainly we, genius, right? So Norm is a supporter of
reverse. So it is like that he has written a book, that's it. And then Safe has picked that book as a principal guiding factor.
Okay, so Safe is saying that we picked up this.
Yes, so Safe is saying that we believe in these particular principles.
Yeah.
And he has written a first book called Design Factory. So it's the second version. So there was a first book called Design Factory, which was more or less working on the same concepts. And he is talking about that critical chain, Toyota technique is good, but you can't implement them into a direct product development area because it requires some changes, because you have a priority issues, you have an unpredictable flow, you can't just predict the demand. So that is something he has done. And this guy is becoming quite famous now. Just before this global Scrum gathering, he was a keynote speaker in the Scrum gathering. So even Scrum Alliance and all people are like respecting him a lot nowadays. So it's trending. Okay, so now we get into the layers. It says that nothing beats the agile team. So at the base level, you have agile team. So valuable, fully tested software increment every 2 weeks. So we prescribe 2 weeks sprint. Empower, self-organized, self-managed, cross-functional team operates under the program vision, architecture, and user experience guideline, which is coming from a program layer. Scrum project management, next team, SPAT, technical practices are used, and value is delivered by users to be. So this is what the team does, the lowest level. Then we go into a bit more details. So talks about code quality, you can't scale this patty code, and this is an interesting one. The system must be managed, it will not manage itself. Left to themselves, components become selfish, competitive, independent profit center, and thus destroys the system. Now, kind of a bit, many times people say this is something against the self-organizing team.
Actually, this is a practically true statement. Again, sharing my experience, we were working on multiple teams. There was an authentication team, and mine was a functional team which was working on the UI. The authentication team said, we will work on this, we will not share when we are going to deliver. The delivery times were defined in the release plan, but they were kind of competitive and secretive. They were not telling us what is happening, and we were just waiting for authentication wala component ka aayega, when do we integrate with it. And a lot of challenges. So
Like I keep giving example in my safe training. So human system is expected to be a best. Human body is a very perfect system. Like you can't create a that good system, human life. So what do we want to eat? We want to eat tasty food, which is very heavy to digest. So our liver cannot manage that. Our body cannot manage it, but we want to eat that. So if we just start following what the taste demand is, our system would be out of control. So we keep a goal of our health, ki I need to maintain, I need to have something in place. So you manage your goals. No, tasty hai, but nahi khana hai. So you are managing your system. Why? You have a common goal. So you need to have a common goal, and it says that you put common goals by way of vision, program, backlog, so that complete team remain aligned. And here we talk about, we have two systems. Like the example you were giving, there is a people system and there is a component system. Authentication team may want to consume a lot of UI, which may become too heavy for your performance or for security or for whatever. So you also need to manage as a software solution that we deliver solution by balancing each other demands, not going one part in deep, another part in less. A lot of time, rich UI create a performance issue. So you need to be balanced about how rich UI you need and what is your performance and standing. The same way teams. So two systems. So it becomes more important to manage them because they are working with two systems at one time.
And I believe that's the reason all these frameworks, they talk about constraints. Mm-hmm. Because the moment you make it open, then there is no way of cutting corners. मुझे पता नहीं था, आई डिडंट नो, दैट्स द रीजन एवरी
ट्रांसपेरेंसी डज हेल्प. एंड हियर क्या अबाउट, लेट्स पुट एन एम
ऑन.
सो एम इज लाइक समथिंग वी पुट इट बाय बाय प्रोग्राम बैकलॉग, बाय प्रोग्राम फीचर, बाय प्रोग्राम रोड मैप. सो यू गिव अ डायरेक्शन टू ऑल और 5-10 टीम्स एंड देन दे रिमेन अलाइन. सो प्रोग्राम लेवल self organized, self managed team of agile teams, working system increment every 2 weeks, so they increment aligned to a common mission by a single backlog. So complete 100 people who are working in a train has a single backlog, which is the program backlog, which will be used, common length and estimating. So the point which Sanjay was mentioning, say it does talk about normalizing an estimate. It does talk about that we need to have a common mechanism to identify and do an estimation. And we also need to have a common mechanism to identify cost of per story. Like when I say 100 story point, I should have a some rough idea what does it mean in dollar term. So it does talk. Then face-to-face release planning cadence for collaboration. So the example we were talking about. And features are delivered, the value is delivered via features. Something like this. Developer cadence. Release on demand. So you always work on PIs, but you may have some releases, some upgrades, some major release which can come anytime. So you develop occurs on a fixed cadence, but business decides when they want to release the event. So we don't bind these two things together. Keep them independent. Stay lean. So final thing, portfolio level. The system is a network of interdependent component and which is trying to keep an aim. So at the same point we were discussing, so we need to put an aim to a system which is coming from a portfolio. So it's a centralized strategy, decentralized execution. So we centralized, we allocate budgets and do other things. Lean agile budgeting, so how do we allocate money and all. None of the framework talks about that, the one which we have discussed. Allocate budgets, how do we do an estimation at that particular level, business case, nobody goes in that level. Kanban system, we provide visibility to WIP limits, enterprise architecture. Now, not only a technical architect, you also talk about enterprise architect. So, enterprise architect is the person who looks at a technological direction at a coordination level. So, we do recognize the goal of that particular person and we do include him into our process. So, enterprise architect. And he may create, we need to move to MySQL. No more MSSQL. Enterprise architect has decided. So going forward, all we need to move on open source. All storage has to be cloud storage. Enterprise architect. It is a company level technological direction. So we can integrate that thought process also. So objective metrics from a governance and Kaizen, and business is delivered through business ethics and architecture ethics. And finally, you have a circle which makes sure that you have a highest authority body, which is called program portfolio management, which sits on the program portfolio level, which talks about we make the strategy, we fund the programs, and then we have a metrics is governance, transparency-based governance, which ensures that the complete loop is closed. The example I was giving, where the governance was not coming in, the loop back was not there. We were not planning anything, then we started planning good, but without getting a feedback of a planning, it was not becoming. So knowledge workers, leaderships, it is like leader should take a system view, focus on agile manifesto. So this is more like a theory. So this is something like that. Next step we can take a trainings becomes lean agile. So this was kind of an introduction of SAFe.